Hello and welcome to Inside Germany, where every week we invite a guest onto the programme who lives here in Germany but doesn't originally come from here. Now, this city, Berlin, has been very cool for some time now. It's attracting a lot of artists who like the lifestyle and the freedom here. Many say it's very different to the rest of Germany, indeed the rest of Europe. Today on the show is an Englishman who's actually spent a lot of time living outside of his home country, Britain, for quite a time in New York, and more recently in Berlin. He is also, in my humble opinion, one of the more interesting composers of popular music around today. Yes, I'm a fan. Gives me great pleasure to welcome Mr. Joe Jackson.
Thank you.
You've lived here for about 5 years now, but did your fascination with Berlin start before that?
Well, yeah, because I first came to Berlin when it still had a wall around it, and I always found it very interesting, yeah.
And before you lived here, you lived in New York for 20 years.
Yeah, something like that.
I mean, are you a bit of a nomad, a wanderer?
I think it's more a question of trying to find somewhere where I feel comfortable, you know, and free, and where I feel like I'm treated like an adult.
Mm-hmm. And wasn't that the case in Britain?
No. I don't think it ever has been, but I think it's gotten worse. I think New York has changed very much. I think I'm not the only person who's here in Berlin who used to live in New York and who feels that in some ways Berlin is kind of like New York used to be 20 or 30 years ago. In a good way.
How does that define itself?
It's just freer and more relaxed and more fun.
Yeah. You're originally from Portsmouth, which is kind of my neck of the woods, and we're about the same age. So, if I may say, Portsmouth wasn't when we were growing up, and you've said that in your book, actually, as well, that wasn't the most beautiful of places.
No.
And I wonder, it was very heavily bombed in the Second World War, before our time, admittedly. Yeah. But I wonder, what was your relationship as a kid with all things German? I mean, what did you think of Germany? Was it...
Well, most people at the time didn't really know anything about Germany except the Nazis. And unfortunately, it's still very much the same way in England, I think. I mean, I was a bit different to the other kids because I... got interested in music and started taking violin lessons when I was 11. And I became a big fan, I still am, of Beethoven, especially. He's still my favourite musician ever. And Bach, too. So I think growing up, I at least had the sense that, well, hang on a minute, these guys were Germans too, so, you know, maybe the Germans aren't all bad.
Mm. Portsmouth isn't known as a hub of music.
So it's not known as a hub of anything except the Navy.
How did you get into music? Was it Beethoven that sort of started you off, and how did it go on from there?
Well, I mean, the first music I remember hearing was things like the Beatles and the Stones and so on, but I wasn't really very much aware of music. Apart from anything else, Portsmouth was a musical desert, you know. I mean, really a cultural desert in a lot of ways. And I only started the violin lessons to try and escape from school sports. And I just found myself fascinated by music, learning about music, learning to read music and all that.
When did you kind of realise you were quite good at it?
I don't know.
I could give you a little pointer. Timpani in the school orchestra.
Oh, yeah, right. I just did anything that was available musically. You know, if there was an instrument, if there was someone there who was teaching a certain instrument. I mean, I played the oboe for about 6 months just because an oboe teacher appeared, you know. I just wanted to do anything that had anything to do with music. And I was interested in all kinds of music and was never, you know, a snob about it.
Mm. And you actually, again, you're quite a rare breed because you're I don't like to call you a pop musician, but a popular musician. But you studied classically.
Yeah.
You went to the Royal Academy of Music. What was that like? Was it a sort of square peg in a round hole? Or?
It was a bit, because I wasn't until I went to the Royal Academy that I realised that I was working class, for one thing. And you know, that I sort of didn't fit in. I thought, won't it be great to go to a place where it's just all musicians? But I actually didn't like most of them. And some of the worst were the people who, like me, were composition was our main subject. The composers were an incredibly pretentious bunch who just seemed to have no connection to real life. So I sort of turned my back rather on classical music then, I think. I mean, I was doing gigs with rock bands in horrible pubs and naval bases and so on. And even though it was really pretty awful in retrospect, it felt more like real life somehow than what was going on at the Royal Academy of Music.
Yeah, well, because if I'm right, after that, you got very interested in punk. And punk music, I mean, was famous, if you like, for people who couldn't play their instruments.
They couldn't even tune them up.
Yeah. Well, how come it was an attraction then? Was this the...
I thought it was great fun. You know, I don't know how, if I really took it as seriously as some people did, as some kind of political movement or social comment or whatever. I think that there was an element of that. But for me, it was just, you know, I was 22 or 23 years old or something, and this was happening, and it was new, and it was kind of exciting and fun. So I was just like everyone else, really, in the time and place. I mean, it influenced me. I went to see The Clash and thought they were amazing, and, you know, so...
And has... Do you think in the long run, looking back now, has classical music been a help or a hindrance? Is it...
Well, it's definitely a hindrance if you want to be a punk rocker. I mean, it didn't occur to me when I was a music student that you could be too good a musician. I mean, it just didn't occur to me.
Yeah. Talking about great musicians, let's turn to Ellington. You've done many albums, and you're a composer yourself. You've had hits, but you've done a covers album of Duke Ellington. Why?
Oh, well, I mean, okay. There's some people that you can't sum up their appeal and what's great about them in one sentence. And that's what makes them great, in a way. I mean, Ellington, to me, is like Beethoven or Shakespeare or Einstein. You know, you could spend a lifetime studying Ellington. He's one of my heroes for a lot of reasons, as a musician and as a man, actually. I have great admiration for Ellington. There's a huge catalogue of music there. And the main point, I think, is that I felt there were a lot of ways to reinterpret his music that hadn't really been done. And, you know, in a way, I think that, I don't know, maybe I'm sort of oddly qualified to do it because I'm a jazz fan and I know a lot about jazz, but I'm not really a jazz musician. So, you know, I felt that there was enough, at least new ideas about Ellington, for better or worse, you know, to do an album of Ellington music reinterpreted in a way that it's really a Joe Jackson album, actually, but just based on Ellington's music.
I mean, I must admit, I'd lost a bit track of your music in the last years, and then I saw this Joe Jackson Plays Ellington, and I'm a big Ellington fan, know quite a lot about the music of that time, so I thought, uh-oh, and I was quite sceptical, especially when I heard there's no brass, really, on the album.
No horns.
So, I wonder how you came across the arrangements in your head. How did you, you know, you've used some extraordinary things in the arrangements, like accordion and...
Yeah, all kinds of things. Everything except horns, really. Well, I wanted to find a way to, or a few ways, actually, to take it away from sounding like Ellington. And the no horns thing was something that I hit on very early on, and it became a rule. I mean, sometimes I think when you're trying to create something, you're trying to give it an identity. And the way you do that sometimes is by actually giving yourselves rules and restrictions. And, you know, it's defined sometimes as much by what you don't do as what you do. Because otherwise the possibilities are literally endless and you end up nowhere. So paradoxically, I think having restrictions and limitations is liberating.
You know,
like, for instance, when you say no horns, then you have to think, okay, now what else can I do then? And then the adventure begins.
Was it liberating with your own music? In that you did a concert recently here in Berlin that I was at, and in one of your big hits, Is She Really Going Out With Him, you did it a completely new arrangement with tuba and accordion.
Yeah.
Why?
For a laugh.
Oh, just for a laugh?
Yeah, for fun.
Okay.
That's why I do all this, really.
Yeah.
Because it's fun. But also, it's good to change things around. I mean, when you're still doing a song that you wrote more than 30 years ago, you know, I mean, sometimes you just have to find a new way of doing it.
Okay. Now, you also chose some interesting artists to perform on the record. Perhaps the most fascinating choice was a man who you don't immediately associate with Duke Ellington or indeed your music, a man with the surname Pop. More of him coming up, but first, more about the making of the album Duke from Mr. Joe Jackson himself.
This project's been in gestation since I was a teenage music student. It looked initially like being a logistical nightmare, and I couldn't quite figure out how to get a handle on it. And I started doing a lot of research and trying to think, well, what can I do with this? Can I take it in a different direction that's going to be interesting, different enough to what's been done before? But I found that once I got started, all the people involved really gave a lot to it, and it just all seemed to start falling into place.
Everyone knows the chorus. It don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing. Right, but not many people know there's actually a verse that goes before it. What use is melody? What use is music if it ain't possessing something sweet? And I thought, what about if I try singing it lower? So, what use is melody? What use? And I thought, that's kind of interesting, but my voice doesn't really have a great, resonance, a deep resonance in that register. And then for some reason I started hearing Iggy's voice in my head. I thought, that's interesting. And I pulled out one of his albums, and there's a song that I love. Right. And the passenger. I can't do it, but it's in exactly the range that I was fooling around in. And I thought, I wonder if he'd like to sing on this track.
What good is melody? What good is music if it ain't possessing something sweet? It ain't the melody, it ain't the music, it's something else that makes the tune complete.
Yeah, I mean, what I wanted to do with this record was take it away from being a jazz record, really.
I have to say, on this project, there have been really great responses from a lot of people that I never thought I could work with. People from all over the place on this album. We have Zuko 103, who are Lillian is Brazilian, and we have Susan Dehim, who's from Iran, singing.
And having worked with Susan before, I got in touch with her. She was really, she loved the idea. But someone was going to have to do a translation of the lyrics, and she ended up doing it herself. And I think she did a pretty good job. Not that I'm fluent in Farsi.
My guest is the musician Joe Jackson, and this is his new CD, The Duke. And this particular copy could be yours. He's promised me he'll sign it, so it'll be a signed copy. I'll give you the details of how you can win this later in the show. That's got to be a first, hasn't it? Ellington in Farsi, I'd imagine.
I think so.
Yeah.
But the English lyrics were terrible anyway.
Yeah, he's not known for his lyrics.
Well, he didn't write them. And, they were generally added to instrumental pieces after the fact by all kinds of people. I mean, God knows. Some of them not bad, some of them just dreadful.
Although the English lyrics to the verse of It Don't Mean a Thing, I quite like.
That's not bad, because it's quite simple, that's okay. Yeah. But, that was another thing I thought early on, is how am I going to get around the fact that some of these songs have terrible lyrics? And I thought, well, what if they're sung in a different language by a singer from, for instance, Iran, in the case of Susan? And so they sound exotic again, unless you're Iranian.
Possibly, yes. I mean, it does. It does sound very exotic. You're right. That was Caravan. Yeah. He's not known for his lyrics. You are. You write lyrics. And was the temptation ever to write any new lyrics for his?
No, I don't know. I think that might have been going a bit too far, maybe. And actually one of the nice things about this project was not having to write lyrics anyway, because that's always the hardest part.
Is it really?
Yeah. I mean, I've gotten better at it over the years, but...
I was going to ask.
You know, music has always come more naturally to me than words.
Yeah. But you say it lyrics come easier to you now, but there's not the anger of youth.
Well, no, there's the anger of whatever phase of my life I'm in now.
A lot of people in their lives, musicians, have writer's block, if you like, and I believe you had that at one time, back in the 90s. What happened?
Yeah. What happened?
Yeah, I mean, did you just... Couldn't you write?
It's all a bloody mystery to me. I don't really know why it happened or why it went away after a while. Honestly, I don't really know.
Are you more prolific now with writing?
I'm less prolific than I was when I was younger. Because I used to just kind of throw things together and think, yeah, that'll do, and put it out. I was more of a workaholic. I felt like I had to keep putting out records. I don't really feel that anymore. I quite often I'll have ideas, and I mean, sometimes I've written like a whole lyric for a song and rejected it, started all over again, for instance. I think that is something that does happen to a lot of people as they get older. You get a bit more self-critical, or you think, well, yeah, but I've done that before, or someone else has done it before. And, you know, I'm more concerned with trying to come up with something new. And I think it gets harder if you get fussier. But that's not necessarily a bad thing.
Let's turn to moving around again. New York. You said in another interview that one of the things that attracted you to New York was that however weird you are, there's always someone weirder. Was that an attraction of Berlin?
Oh, well, I think it's generally an attraction of big cities. Yeah, big cosmopolitan cities. And having grown up in a provincial town, I think I always wanted to get out.
You were in New York, actually, on September the 11th.
Yes.
Weren't you? Yeah.
I heard the planes going over
really?
There. It woke me up, yeah.
Did it?
I was asleep.
I mean, I think we all know it's changed New York. Did it change New York for you, that?
I think it... I really think it changed New York enormously. I mean, I think it sort of blew a big hole in the heart of the city, you know, and... I don't think it's really recovered. I think it, in a lot of ways, it's sort of tried to fill the hole with more and more branches of Starbucks and, you know, I don't know, between that and the reign of Mayor Bloomberg's reign of terror, I think, you know, the city changed so much. I don't know. I mean, you know, I still go back quite a lot. There's still some things about it that are great because it's, you know, a big, big, important city and it has a lot of stuff. But I don't enjoy it like I used to somehow.
There's one thing that occurred to me that is a similarity between New York and Berlin, though, is that these are both cities where people like yourself can wander around undisturbed.
Yeah.
Is that important for you?
Yeah. I mean, it depends how you're disturbed, of course. I mean, who does the disturbing? But I do. I like the anonymity of a big city. Sure.
Yeah. You like to observe rather than be observed, perhaps. Is that part of being an artist? Or
yeah, it is. Actually, it's funny because that reminds me of an interview I once read with Joni Mitchell, where she said that success is bad for an artist because you go from being an observer to being observed. I think she was spot on with that.
And have you...
So why are you on TV now, I hear you thinking?
Well, no.
Because we have to promote ourselves, otherwise, you know, we can't continue to do what we love and afford to live off it.
What I was going to ask, perhaps, was... And yet, I've seen you on stage a few times, and when you're on stage, it's your place. So there's this urge to perform in front of a public.
Yeah. The connection with the audience is the most important thing, and live is where it happens. It doesn't happen in a studio. Working in the studio is fun in a lot of other ways, but to me the best thing has always been performing to an audience.
But if somebody came up to you in a bar in Berlin and said, oh, well, can I have your autograph, would that upset you?
No, it doesn't upset me. I mean, I don't really have a problem with it. But, you know, I mean, they're a human being, I'm a human being, and every human interaction is different.
Yeah.
And so, you know, people say, what do you think when people approach you? It depends, you know.
But do you feel you can be here and, apart from doing this television programme, which, by the way, doesn't go out in Berlin, it goes out to the rest of the world, do you feel you can you can live here anonymously better than in other places?
Pretty much so. But, I mean, I don't mind being recognised now and again, especially if it's by someone that says, hey, I really enjoyed your last album. I mean, I have to be pretty misanthropic or a bit of a miserable bastard to have a problem with that.
Yeah. Well, I really enjoyed this. As I say, we're going to give a signed copy away later, but right now, my guest won a Grammy for his Symphony No. 1, which was an instrumental album. Beethoven wrote a few symphonies too. And my guest is now resident in the country of Beethoven, Bach and Brahms.
For the past 5 years, Joe Jackson has been living here in the heart of Berlin. He enjoys strolling around the multicultural district he chose as his Berlin home and is rarely bothered by fans. The German capital is quite cosmopolitan, but also has a foreign feeling he likes. In summer 2007, he recorded an album in Berlin at a sound studio that belonged to the official East German state radio in the days before the fall of the wall. He brought in his old bass player and drummer from his band back in the 80s, and the resulting CD was called Rain.
It was always raining when I was writing these songs for some reason. And every day that we were recording in Berlin, it rained. And then finally, when we finished recording, it stopped raining. It's amazing. But also, I like the idea of this very simple title that's very kind of universal. It's the only time I ever had an album title that's just one word.
Joe Jackson is very much a citizen of the world. After his initial pop star fame in Britain in the 1980s, he moved to New York. Now Berlin is home for him. He really enjoys the fact that nobody really knows him here, because the life of a pop star is completely alien to him.
Being on the other side of fame or success is actually better, you know, because I don't see how you can be a celebrity and have any sort of dignity as a human being at the same time, and be an artist. Very few people can do all three of those things at the same time.
Joe Jackson in Berlin, at home, on stage, and off.
That just there, I was seeing you're playing with your old mate, Graham Mabey and Dave Houghton.
Yeah.
Do you still play with them? Or, I mean, the band you've got now isn't with them.
Yeah. We played as a trio together for, you know, the last few years. Did more shows together than I've done with any other combination of musicians, actually. The trio thing was great. It was a very interesting challenge. Do you know, how much can you do with three people? And for this project, the Duke, I went almost in the other direction entirely. I've got the biggest band I can afford on the road right now. Yeah. And I can't even really afford it, actually. But, you know, it's really, it's a lot of fun.
Good. There's one celebrity who you've worked with who, to me, I'm a big fan, actually, who's used his celebrity to his own ends with great effect to make a kind of second career for himself. I'm talking about William Shatner, Captain Kirk from Star Trek. Now, I wasn't a fan of Star Trek. I've been a fan of his. Oh, you were?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow. So what was... So is this... I mean, I was going to say, how did you come to work with him? Were you sort of knocking on his door?
No, it came through a guy called Ben Folds, who you might have heard of.
Yeah, yeah,
who'd,
Ben Folds, fine.
Had met Shatner and somehow or other ended up arranging and writing and producing an album with him based on Shatner's lyrics, which he speaks and he doesn't sing, thank God. And Ben Folds is a big fan of mine, and, you know, when Ben Folds calls you up and says, how would you like to play or sing on an album by William Shatner? I mean, what are you going to do? Of course you're going to do it.
But, I mean, he's not the greatest musician in the world, is he?
Who?
Well, not Ben Folds. Ben Folds is a very good musician. I'm sure about William Shatner.
That's not really the point.
And is he as funny as I think he is?
Yeah, yeah, he's pretty cool.
Because he really is the one person who's... He takes the... I say takes the mickey, but that's a very English phrase. I have to think of... He takes fun out of himself in great swathes of it, really.
Oh, yeah, totally.
Yeah, yeah. You have a difficult relationship with the media. We've talked about you like your... So thanks for being here, first of all. But you did turn journalist yourself a few years back when you wrote a detailed essay called Smoke, Lies and the Nanny Stay.
Oh, yeah.
Now, you immediately got a reputation as being a sort of smokers' rights campaigner. And indeed, the press here reported that you moved to Berlin because you could smoke in some bars. Is there any sort of truth in that?
Well, there's some truth to it, but it's just part of the bigger picture, really. I mean, it would be just as accurate to say I moved here because the pubs don't throw me out at 11 o'clock like they do still most of them in England. In fact, most pubs in England now, not only can you not smoke and that they throw you out at 11 o'clock, but they also have CCTV cameras, and I could go on and on, you know. So, no, I think there's just a generally a more free attitude here that I appreciate.
Yeah, well, I read the essay again, and it's 20 pages long with lots of research. You obviously went in great detail, but it's not really about smoking. It's more about freedom, or personal freedom, shall we say.
Well, freedom from being pushed around in more and more petty and personal ways by an overbearing state, you know, based on fear-mongering. I mean, this is what I have a problem with. And it's going beyond smoking and getting very much into areas of drink and food and how much you weigh and all these other things. And it's really happening to a huge extent in the UK, I would say, to a great extent in parts of the US, in Australia, where the state is getting more and more involved in your personal life and how you choose to spend your free time as an adult. And I think it's a worrying trend, and it seems to be happening much less in Germany than it is in other places. There is still some of it happening, and I think, you know, it may well get worse. I don't know. We'll see.
Yeah, it's interesting about Germany, because the cliche of Germany in many ways is that it's a place that has lots of rules and regulations. Mm. And your experience is that there are less, perhaps, here.
Or maybe different kinds. I don't know. Germans seem to be less tolerant of the state telling them how to live and how to enjoy their free time, I think.
Yeah, I think this is part of history, of course.
I mean,
1933, the state was telling them everything. And, of course, there's a federal system here. I also thought from reading your thing that health is the new religion. And is that...
Yeah, I think it is. I think that politicians these days, in order to give themselves a sort of veneer of believability or credibility or importance, tend to put on the white coat of the doctor, as opposed to, you know, the uniform of the army or the robes of the priest or whatever they used in the past, the divine right of kings, or, you know, they've got to have something that gives them a legitimacy, and the way that they get to push us around these days always has something to do with health or safety, and they're generally extremely exaggerated or even non-existent things that are brought up to frighten us, and they're very deliberately exaggerated to frighten us. And I really believe that, and I've done a hell of a lot of research on it as well. But people's attitude generally, when I say things like, you know, secondhand smoke really isn't going to kill you guys. I mean, it really isn't. If you look at the facts, people don't want to hear it. You know, they get very upset. They go, la, 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 la.
Are you still? You say you've done a lot of research on that, but are you still sort of? Are you going to write again about it, or are you involved in writing about this personal freedom now? I don't know.
I mean, you know, I don't know if I've probably done about as much as I can. I mean, people generally, like I said, they don't want to hear it because they say, well, you're a musician, you're not a doctor, so why should I believe anything you say? And, of course, you don't have to. I mean, I'm just saying, do your own research.
OK, I don't think anyone disputes the fact that smoking is not good for your health. Let's briefly meet some people who want the no-smoking laws tightened up even more here in Berlin.
Dr. Johannes Spatz and his friends are doing a bit of bar hopping in Berlin. But they're not doing it for fun. They want to find out if local bylaws concerning smoking in public spaces are being adhered to. Test number one. The cigarette is permitted, the camera is not.
Excuse me, we're from the Fresh Air for Berlin campaign. So that room there is a smoker's room, right? And here, well, this is a bit disappointing.
In Berlin's Wild West, it seems anything goes. The clean air activists are underway in one of the city's hippest neighborhoods. The Weserstrasse scene attracts tourists from all over the world. They love it because it's so free. But smoke-free, it is not.
You need to turn that into a smoker's room.
But non-smokers would have to go through it to get to the toilets, and that's not allowed.
That's right. So you'll have to change the whole floor plan.
So far, the city council has been rather lax on a rule that says only one-room bars up to 75 square meters can allow smoking. Something the campaign Fresh Air for Berlin wants to change. They've collected thousands of signatures in order to put more pressure on the city government.
I should mention here at this point that smoking, on the whole, is illegal here in the German capital, but some of the laws are a bit sort of lax and people... It's changing, actually, more and more. There are lots of loopholes in the law, and as they said in the report, if you have a bar of 75 metres and you call it a smoking bar, you're allowed it and things, and this can change, but... You made a point while that was on that a bar is not a public place.
Yeah, I mean, one of the problems I have with these smoking bans is that it's government blurring the line between what's public and what's private. I mean, a bar is not government property, and it's not public property either. It's not supported by taxation. It is a private place, not a public place. You don't have to go in there. And if the air isn't clean enough, you improve the ventilation. Or you have a separate room. If that's not good enough, you can have a choice for smoking or non-smoking places. Most reasonable people don't have a problem with that. But the point is that you hear sometimes these anti-smokers will say, you have no right to pollute my air. As a smoker, I could say, well, you have no right to prevent me from enjoying illegal pleasure because it's my air too. Mm. How do you resolve that argument? You have to say, well, whose air is it? In the case of a bar, it's the guy who owns the bar.
Let's talk about something else in a bar, because I know, or I read, you were, or perhaps you still are, a fan of real ale. So how does German beer, I mean, was that an attraction of coming here?
Definitely, definitely.
Yeah?
I like good beer. I mean, it can be German-style beer or English-style beer or Czech-style beer, for instance. I mean, if it's good, I like it. But that's one of the great things about Germany. It's not the greatest country to eat in, but it's a great country to drink in.
And... Over the years, you've toured Germany a lot, and that I did in the past as well. You're always discovering new beers.
Yeah. Well, it's one of the great things about Germany, let's face it.
And the whole drinking culture, too. I mean, you were saying that the bars don't close at 11, but you don't see here, you don't see here the drunkenness that you see in... other countries sometimes who restrict things. It's this restriction thing, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, the more you restrict it, the worse it gets. I mean, look, I may be somewhat biased on this because the world of bars and pubs and nightclubs and so on is my world. I'm a musician, you know, that's my business is to be part of that world, to be part of the world of pleasure and what adults do in their free time. And I think that it works best when there's as little interference as possible from government or politicians, because they don't really get that world. And, you know, it really, the more they stay away from it, the better it is. It's an area where adult citizens should work things out among themselves. And, you know, I mean, I've spoken to people in England about this. They say, what time do the bars close in Berlin then? I say, well, whenever they feel like it. I say, well, that can't work, can it? Well, why not? I mean, it works a lot better than the system in England.
Do you think you'll win the battle? Not you personally, but do you think the battle will be won?
What do you mean?
Well, I mean, there'll be less...
The battle
nanny
against
state.
The nannies. Mm. The nannies are doing very well. They're on a roll. And, you know, the chances are things will get worse. But you don't know, because, you know, the only way to try to predict the future is to assume that current trends are going to continue, and usually they don't. Mm. So the future is, by definition, unpredictable.
Let's get back to your music. Your biggest hits, like... Stepping Out, She Really Going Out With Him, Jumping Jive, Different For Girls, my personal favourite slow song. Do you still play them on stage? Do you still enjoy playing them? Do you still enjoy revisiting them?
Yeah, I mean, you can tell the ones I don't enjoy so much because we don't play them.
Okay.
You know, I mean, it is my band after all. I think we should play what I want to play.
Yeah, but you did.
I think it is important to give the audience some things that are familiar. I think, I like that when I go to see a show too. But I always think it works best if it's a mixture of the familiar and an element of surprise.
And new arrangements. Sometimes.
Oh yeah, yeah,
yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, as I said. A couple of weeks ago, Joe Jackson was here in Berlin with his band, and our cameras were there too, and I was too. Let's have a little taster of that concert.
So, after a tour of 35 European and American cities, this concert in the German capital was something of a homecoming. He performed songs from his latest album, but also some of his pop classics.
Amazing gig. I was totally impressed. It was really good. Brilliant musicians and a great show. It doesn't get any better than this. The best in the business. Still and for decades. I love him.
He was great. Now, before we go on, this week you can write in to win this wonderful new CD from my guest, Joe Jackson. So just write to us at insight@dw.de and you could be our lucky winner. And I say lucky because I know the CD, I've seen him play selections from it live, and I unreservedly recommend it. And he's going to sign it as well before we go. And it really is a fascinating CD with lots of different styles on it, actually, although it's Ellington.
Yeah.
What's next? Have you got, I mean, you write and compose yourself. Have you got a lot of stuff stacked up because you've been busy with that?
Yeah, I got some bits and pieces lying around, yeah. But I think hopefully we're going to do a little bit more touring with this band in the summer next year because it was just too good not to do some more. So I'm thinking about that and some other things, yeah. But I never like to talk too much about, you know, what I'm working on or what I'm going to do next.
What about Ellington's sacred music, though? Do you know that?
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty it's interesting. I mean, yeah, it's I must say it's not my favourite music of his, but I mean, I think pretty much everything he did was at least interesting.
Yeah. I've always thought, not always thought, while I was researching this, I thought you're the perfect person to write a musical in that you've got the classical training, you've got a foot in the pop field, you like jazz and you're good at that as well. And I know there is thing going on, Bram Stoker, yeah, Stoker musical. Is it going to happen?
It's been going on for years. It's it is a musical theatre piece. It's not really a musical like a cheesy Hollywood Broadway type of musical. It's a theatre piece that has music in it. Very interesting and quite original piece, I think, about Bram Stoker's life and his what went on in his head and how he created Dracula. But it's at the stage now where it's out of my hands and other people are trying to get it produced, get it staged. And in the time that this has been going on, the theatre world is just a new thing to me and I really don't understand it at all. During the time we've been working on this project, it's been, I've done 3 albums and God knows how many tours.
Oh, well, we'll look out for that one. And Joe Jackson, it's been a great pleasure to have you here on the show. Thanks very much for being with us. Thanks very much for you for listening. And I'll be back at the same time next week with another interesting guest. That's it from Inside Germany for this week. For myself and all the crew here in Berlin, bye-bye.